Welcome to a review of Block and Key from Canadian publisher Inside Up Games. We have to thank for letting us take a review copy of this spatial reasoning game home from Origins 2023.
Block and Key was designed by David Van Drunen and features artwork by Udo Vallis. Udo Vallis. It was originally kickstarted back in 2022. Now you can pick up the retail version direct from Inside Up Games, from many online retailers, and potentially at your friendly local game store.
Now this striking board game plays 1 to 4 players with games taking under an hour. It features a nice low weight, making the basic gameplay easy to pick up and accessible to gamers young and old.
Now Block and Key has players exploring an ancient temple trying to solve riddles which involve finding and placing blocks or something like that. This is an abstract game with a very three-dimensional look to it. It has players drafting, then placing clay blocks onto a dual-layer board, attempting to match patterns on their hand of cards, while also simultaneously trying to mess with their opponents so they can't match their patterns. Now, of course, the neat bit here is that only your two-dimensional view of the blocks from your side of the board are what matters to you.
Yeah, there's a little bit of pasted on theming here, but the dual layered board and actual clay blocks are a key part of this game, and you can see them in our Block and Key unboxing video on YouTube.
And there you can also see me fumble around with trying to set up the board properly for the first time. And note to anyone, do not try to pick it up from the bottom shelf, because the bottom shelf isn't actually attached, it's just sitting there. I also do show off the slightly confusing rule book, which now makes a lot more sense than it did when I recorded the unboxing. You know, the flap I complain about is actually so you can leave the examples open and visible as you flip through the book, and so that you can see them in multiple languages. It's actually kind of smart, but it is weirdly floppy. I, of course, show off the blocks themselves and the various card decks.
Now, the component quality ranges from fantastic to baffling. For example, the box comes in a very thin, easily damaged sleeve. A sleeve that they also spent money to add UV spot coating to make the gold shine.
Yeah.
A sleeve that was already showing wear after our second play. Then there's the images on the board that are meant to be rule references, but are frankly quite confusing.
Yeah, they did unique artwork on each side of the board. And when I don't know, it's an odd choice. Now, on the other end, though, you have the ceramic blocks, which are some of the most pleasing to hold, touch, heft, use, and place board game components I've ever had. They have a real weight to them, and they give you that impression of ancient stone. And I love the way they sound, the clink and clack in the bag. And then in between are the cards, which are clear, easy to read, good quality. They're just good components.
And then there's the method of setting up the double board, which isn't 100% clear, as indicated by the many pictures we found of people setting it up in different ways.
Yes.
As well as some concerns about how long these verticals are going to last with regular setup and tear down.
So I do have to say, when you build it correctly, it's way more sturdy than you'd expect. But realize that the blocks pushing down is part of it. Again, don't try to lift that box up, maybe by the legs, if you can hold all four at once.
Now, setting up the board is the first step to actually playing Block and Key. Once the board is set up, players need to sit around it. Now, there are specific seating spots at each of the player counts, which is indicated on the board. For example, when playing two players, you need to be next to each other, not opposite each other.
Yeah, more so than most games, where you sit actually matters in Block and Key. This is a game where a smaller table is going to be better, and you want each player to not only be able to face the board squarely, but be able to reach pretty much all of the top board.
Now, once everyone has found a spot, they are each dealt a hand of cards. Two easy starting star cards, one medium sun card, and one hard moon card. Each player also gets one of the four enigma cards. Any remaining star and enigma cards are removed from play, and the remaining sun and moon cards are placed on their designated spots on the bottom layer of the board.
Next, you're going to find the core cube. This is the only 2x2x2 block in the game, and it's given to the start player. The rest of the blocks are placed in the bag, shuffled up, and the market grid on the bottom board is filled with randomly drawn blocks. The starting player is going to place the core cube on the board in its designated spot, choosing whichever side they want to face them. Then in reverse player order, players will draft their starting blocks.
Whenever you are drafting blocks in Block and Key, you choose one column or one row of the market and take all of the blocks from that strip. Now, usually this will be three blocks, but near the end of the game, there may be less. After any blocks are drafted, they are replaced in an order based on the numbers on the board from low to high.
Now, each turn, players have two options. You can excavate blocks, taking a set of blocks, as just described, or you can place a block. When placing a block, you choose one block from your supply and place it onto the board on the top layer, following a pretty restrictive set of placement rules.
The first of these is that a block can be placed so that at least one corner is touching the corner of another block on the board.
Next, a block can be placed touching another block, but the new block must be taller than the highest face of the stacks it touches.
Now, blocks do not have to be placed on the board surface. They can be placed on other blocks. But when doing so, the maximum height of a stack is only six faces.
Finally, bridges are allowed, but overhangs are not.
Now, once you place a block, you can then claim a key by placing a card from your hand that has a pattern on it that matches your unique 2D perspective of the board from the side you are playing on. The block you just played must contribute at least one face to this pattern, so no turning in cards for patterns your opponents complete incidentally.
No patterns on cards can be matched in any orientation, rotated in any way, but not flipped. After turning in one or more cards, trust me, turning in two in one turn feels really good. You then draw replacements, and at that point you can choose. Do you want medium sun cards or hard moon cards to replace the cards you played?
Play continues until a player has played a set amount of cards based on the player count. 12 for two players, 8 for three players, 7 for four. At this point, everyone gets one more turn, and then you calculate your final score.
So each card you played is worth points, which is shown in the top corner of the card. In addition, everyone then scores their Enigma card. Each Enigma card shows one of the game's four colors. Each player will count how much of that color, how many faces they can see on their side of the board, divide that by three, and add that to their card total for a final score.
The player with the most point wins, and there are three different tiebreakers just in case players have the same score.
Now, Block and Key also includes a solo mode where you play through 11 turns trying to score as high as possible. Now, this isn't just a matter of playing the game as usual to get your score. To make things interesting, the Temple Ancients are messing with you and moving blocks on their own. Any turn you don't claim a key card, or you play a card, you're going to take a card and put it face down into what becomes the Ancient deck.
Anytime you draw a new key card, you enact an Ancient's turn, which has you flipping over the top card from this deck and using it to draft and place a single tile on the board, potentially messing with your plans. There's also a system for discarding key cards that I kind of wish was in the main game as well.
Yeah, I would have liked to have seen that. I wonder if there's a variant out there. Now, Block and Key is a game that I almost missed completely and totally. It slipped under my radar. I don't remember the Kickstarter, though I will admit I don't pay as much attention to crowdfunding hotness as I used to, but I also don't remember hearing any hype about this one at all. I'm not saying it's not out there, but I missed it. I only discovered this due to heading to the Inside Up Games booth at Origins 2023, where I was actually hoping to snag a copy of Earth. They were already sold out, so I didn't get that, but we were all in the booth. I spotted this very distinct looking game set up on a demo table.
And while I can enjoy this sort of game, it's the sort I tend to overlook as it's a little gimmicky appearing. And my focus isn't as much on table presence as Mosey is, who's looking for those public play games.
Yeah, this was one, as soon as I saw it, I'm like, it caught my attention. It's going to catch someone else's attention. So Deanna and I went over and took a look at it. I will admit, I was immediately reminded of Mountains Out of Molehills. This is a game we previously reviewed that has a two-layered board. And no, the games really aren't at all that similar, except for the dual-layer board and the fact you're placing stacks of things on top. Mountains is a light programmed movement game for families, where every time you move, you push blocks up, whereas Block and Key is all about building things on top of the board to form patterns.
Physically, the games look potentially very similar at a glance, but that is about it.
So after a short demo by an awesome staff member at Inside Up Games, my initial thoughts was, this seems pretty cool. I get it. Like as soon as they showed me the cards and looking at them, like, I get it. That's cool mechanics. And it reminded me of another game. And I find this is way more similar to Rio Grande's classic game La Boca. And that is another game where you're trying to build blocks to match a set pattern, but that's a partner game where your partner's trying to do the same thing on another card. So it's a totally different game. And it looks fantastic on the table. And as Sean mentioned, I'm always looking for games that catch people's attention to bring out the public play events I host here in Windsor. So I convinced them to send us home with a review copy of the game.
And while we brought it back with high hopes, things then took a turn.
Yeah, I got it home and unboxed it and discovered the component issues we already talked about above. Like, I hate the sleeve. Hate's the right term. I really do not like that sleeve. And the fact there's nothing on the box to indicate what the game is without the sleeve. Yes, I'm going to recognize it. But when I tell my daughter to go downstairs and grab block and key, or I have friends over and I'd say grab block and key, they're not going to be able to find it. And then after a bit, Deanna, Sean, and I are sitting at a local copy shop, and I pack the game and I decide to sit down to learn the game. And we can't figure out how exactly to build the 3D two-layered board. And they're playing around with that while I'm trying to read the game and the instructions. And I hate how floppy the rule book is. It's just not comfortable to read. Kind of reminds me of the old days of trying to read a print newspaper. And I don't know, like the generation before us had a skill at holding newspapers I never developed. And then it's got the fold-out bit, which I totally didn't understand at the time. I do get it now. I don't think I like it now that I get it, but I don't like it. And I got to say, the game left a pretty bad first impression before playing it.
I mean, I admit I'm a sour old fogey anyways, but this game was not selling itself as we fumbled and fiddled and tried to get started playing the game.
Yeah. Though, once we actually did start playing, that changed. We got what we wanted. Well, the placement rules are a bit wonky. They do take a bit to get used to. And the rule book could be a little clearer than it is. That page of examples could show a few more examples. Once you get everything down, this is a fascinating, quick playing, spatial logic puzzle game.
Indeed, once you actually get through the rules and setup, the game just makes sense and flows. It's unfortunate that it is a bit of an uphill battle to get to that point where that game really does start to sing.
Yeah, and to do the game justice, this is something like if you own this, set it up before everyone shows up. Like have it ready to go just so that it's good to go and people get the best first impression, because Block and Fee features a really nice flow and plays quickly. Yes, some players may take more time than others to figure out what to do on their turn, but in general, that just gives the other players an ability to take advantage of that time to plan out their own moves, looking at their blocks and what can be drafted. Though, don't hold on to those plans too close, because it is highly possible the actions of other players will ruin all of that planning. And honestly, that is the key part of what makes this game work. While it sounds like Block and Key is multiplayer solitaire, when you describe it to people like, well, that doesn't sound too hard, it's very much not. And I've found that as players get more experienced, they start figuring out better placements for their blocks. For example, instead of placing this block up here close where I can score this, what if I put it as far away as possible from me so that it's more likely to mess up someone else?
Yeah, as much as the 2D view is the only thing that scores, you still need to keep that third dimension in mind, specifically because it doesn't impact your scoring, but can massively impact that of other players.
Now, while the entire concept of scoring just your 2D view of a set of blocks is brilliant, it does come with a pretty big issue. That is getting into the right place for the right perspective. This is why the game was designed with a two-layer board, so the top layer is at least close to eye level for most players. And while that works, and it's definitely better than having to lean down to get down to table level, you're still going to have to find that you have to swap between basically slouching and craning to see what you need to see. Because you not only want that 2D view, which you want to look at when you're trying to match your pattern, but you need more of a top-down isometric view when placing your blocks so you can see the whole 3D board. And you're constantly kind of swapping between crouching and craning and leaning.
Indeed, if you're the right height to score, you need to stand up to place, and if you're the right height to place, you need to slouch down to score. This is, once you get past the initial speed bumps, the biggest struggle for the game.
Now, another minor complaint I had at first that it didn't feel like there were enough blocks in the game. Like, the bag empties quickly, especially playing at four players, definitely quicker than you'd expect. But I've got to say, now, after playing multiple games, I think this is a feature. I think it's good. Like if you're starting to run out blocks right when people are playing the, you know, that seventh, eighth or 12th card, like it actually fits. But you got to watch for this. This can lead to frustration for players who aren't expecting it. And I know, based on some reactions, it is no fun to be the player who runs out of blocks and sits there while everyone else is still taking turns. Now, while teaching the game, I've adapted my teach to mention this multiple times. And blocks will run out. Oh, there's only three left in the bag. Or remember, you might want to draw some backs before you run out.
Yeah, as much as I feel like every game gets this now, a bit of knowledge about the game helps. Now, it's not exactly system mastery, but that familiarity that helps you not be planning too far ahead when you're just about out of blocks. You don't want to be picking up that moon card when you only got two blocks in front of you and there's only two blocks left to draw to in the bag.
To draw. Yeah, exactly. And I've seen people draft blocks for colors they don't even have on their cards because they're just expecting more blocks and more cards and not for the game to come to an end. So far in the games we've played, we have played this a number of times at different group sets. It's gone over very well with my family, very well. And the local game nights I brought it out to. Now, I gotta say, it does what I wanted it to. It has the presence. It worked on me at Origins, and it works at public play events. Once I have this game set up, if I can get a group playing, especially early in a public play game night, other groups will follow. They'll ask to go next. What are you playing? What's that? What's that? Can I try that? This game was also an unexpected hit with my mother-in-law. My mother-in-law likes puzzles and logic games and spatial things. Now, on the other hand, my youngest daughter did not enjoy it at all, but I think that's more tied to her personal disabilities, like central processing disorder and being able to tell distances.
Now, while I personally don't have any struggles, I can certainly imagine that there are some people, like your daughter, for whom this game would simply misfire. Yeah. But in general, I think these folks know the sort of games and puzzles they don't connect with, so just be aware if that is something that you struggle with or just dislike.
Yeah, overall, we've enjoyed Block and Key more than I expected. It's not just an interesting looking gimmick. The game is a fascinating spatial puzzle that can be much more cutthroat than you expect. Placing blocks and nailing a hard pattern can be very rewarding, as can hearing an opponent groan as you place a block. I'm very glad we took a copy of this one home.
And once you figure out how to set up and play the game, it's really a solid playing game with a lot of potential. Unfortunately, with so many great games on the market these days, those hiccups up front can really sink a game's chances. So I do hope that this review can help people see the good that it achieves on the other side of that setup.
Yeah, if you enjoy spatial puzzles, games with 3D elements, pattern recognition, and matching, you're going to love Block and Key. While it might take a bit to nail down the placement rules, once you've got them, this is a really fast-playing and surprisingly thinky game.
If you have issues with depth perception or having to focus on things at different depths and levels, have any special processing issues or vision issues like color blindness, Block and Key may not work for you. The game is good enough, though. It's worthy maybe checking out a copy at a local event, con, or game store, but don't be surprised if it doesn't work for you.
Now, due to the light nature of the rules of this game, I think this could be a great game for families. For whatever reason, the game's listed at 14+. That's got to be component-based or some kind of regulation-based. There's no reason you have to be 14 to play this game. The rules are simple enough, and because the game rewards pattern recognition more than anything else, I think it puts gamers at different ages and experience levels on the same page. You're not doing math or economics or long-term strategies, right? It's just about recognizing those patterns and making them. I have seen this game go over just as well with seniors as well as with teens, and I think it would work with younger kids as well. I just don't have any younger kids to try it with.
Well, that's it for our thoughts on Block and Key, a very three-dimensional block-placing pattern-matching board game from Inside Up Games that's sure to catch people's attention.
Did you learn something new from this review? Are you now thinking of picking up Block and Key or maybe checking out what else Inside Up Games has to offer? You can tip your bellhop by stopping by patreon.com/tabletopbellhop.